A little while ago, I made a video about my JSRF mission compiler now supporting scripting. But what does that mean exactly? What does scripting do in JSRF? Or in any game for that matter? And how? Today, we're going to answer those questions, and by the end, you ought to have a pretty good understanding of what's going on in that demo I made. So, let's get started. First, what roughly does scripting mean? At least for a game in the 2000s. Imagine developing an Xbox game in 2002. Microsoft has licensed you a copy of the Xbox Development Kit, and with it, you write your game in C++. This being C++, you carefully decide which variables are 16 or 32 bits, you painstakingly allocate memory when you need it for something, and free it when you're done, and so on. Then, whenever you're ready to test it out, you hit compile and wait a while for Visual Studio to do its thing. Now, you program your game engine like this, but when the time comes to put objects in your levels, to define objectives, and so on, this can be a real drag. When you're iterating with your playtesters on what enemies to put in a room, you don't want to think about whatever array those enemies are stored in, or when they're allocated or freed, and you definitely don't want to wait for your whole game to compile again for every small tweak. You want to think at a higher level of abstraction. Put these enemies here, and those ones there. And you want it fast to tighten up that feedback loop with the people testing out the game. So what do? Instead of programming these things directly into your game, you program your engine to read data describing these things, and then follow their instructions. You design your data format to allow expressing all those things like, this item shows up here, or this door opens after talking to that person, and so on. Then the engine can worry about all the low-level stuff like memory, and you don't need to recompile to try out something new. Just prepare new data telling the engine to do something different. A whole lot of games have used this strategy. The first three Crash games famously used a custom compiled list dialect. You can find documentation online on the scripting used in Paper Mario, and so on. And as you probably already realize, JSRF does this as well. So I'll spend the rest of our time today explaining precisely how JSRF scripting expresses concepts like put this here and make that happen. JSRF's scripting is stored in its mission files. In fact, you could even argue that mission files in their entirety are JSRF scripts, but I'll focus on a specific part of them here. To get an idea of what scripts are responsible for, let's start from zero and see what we get if we remove all the scripting from a mission. I'll replace the tutorial with Chapter 2 Cho Street so we can access it from the main menu, and I've disabled all of its scripting. What happens? Well, if you watch the CXPX debugger, you will notice the game loading some stuff, like the Cho Street stage files, Yo-Yo's assets, Poison Jam, and so on. But after that, the game dutifully does what it was told to. Absolutely nothing. Now, to be clear, the game did actually load up Cho Street, but we got a black screen because a camera was never created for us to see it through. So, it turns out you can't get very far in JSRF without scripting. Let's add in the minimum amount of scripting to get our player character in the world so we can actually see what things are like with the rest of the scripting disabled. So we've got our mission file. Where does the scripting go? The mission has a header with a few different parts, and what we want is this big table of what I'll call blocks in the file. Each entry in the table points to an offset in the file and gives the number of items in it. The last four entries point to the four scripting blocks, that is, lists of function calls. I disable the scripting by setting the number of items in each of these four lists to zero. Most of the other blocks are actually just data for these function calls to reference. As to why there are four lists, we'll get to that later, and we'll just worry about the first one for now. Every function in this list is called once at the start of the mission. So, what's in a function call? Each call in the list is 84 bytes, which I'll break into three parts. 16 bytes that I'll skip for the moment, a 4-byte opcode that identifies the function we're calling, and 64 bytes for up to 16 4-byte arguments to that function. These arguments are usually integers, but can also rarely be floats or pointers to text elsewhere in the file. Let's add a call to spawn our character, which is opcode hex48. I actually haven't figured out all the arguments for this function yet, but they include things like which controller the character is controlled by, and whether to use some fancy camera effect for spawning them in. Where the character actually spawns depends on some external factors, but in this case, they'll spawn at the first set of coordinates specified in another block in the mission file. So, with YoYo spawned into our mission, we can now see what else is missing with all the other scripting disabled. No pedestrians, cars, pickups, graffiti, moving objects, water, death warps, level exits, street challenge triggers, and so on. So how do we get these back? Most are just additional function calls to create these things, so long as we provide the necessary data in other parts of the file. But we can only get so far without the ability to express logic. So how do we express logic? Well, function calls are able to read and write a few sets of flags. That part at the beginning of the call that we skipped earlier is pointers to flags to read and write, plus the number of flags that they're pointing to, that is. Flags that we read are conditions. They must all check out, that is, each named flag must have a specified value in order for the call to run. Writes are performed after successful completion of a call, setting flags to specified values. There are four sets of flags: mission-specific flags that are cleared when we change missions, chapter-specific flags that are cleared when we start a new chapter in the story, global flags that are never cleared, and special flags with extra functionality like unlocking tutorials. With these flags at our disposal, we can decide whether or not to run a given function at the beginning of a mission, and we can write stuff to read in another mission or upon returning to this one. But how do we make things happen during a mission? How do we trigger a victory dance when all the graffiti is cleared, or spawn a graffiti soul when a street challenge is completed? We're going to have to talk about the other three lists of mission calls, and precisely how the game executes scripting frame by frame. Let's take this one piece at a time. The first list we already know is what I usually call the immediate function calls, because they're called immediately at the start of the mission. Let's contrast this against the third list, which I call non-blocking calls, a name that will make more sense later. Most function calls that can be used in the immediate calls list can also be used in the non-blocking calls list, but instead of this list being run once at the start of the mission, this list is run every frame. Now, you don't usually want to call a function every frame, so we can use flags to call a function just once. Condition the call on a flag not being set, and then set that flag upon completion of the call. When the next frame comes around, that flag will be set, and our condition check will fail, preventing the function from running again. Next is the second list, what I call listener calls. Like non-blocking calls, these are run every frame. The difference is that the functions we can call on this list are completely different, and all of them serve a particular purpose. Rather than making anything happen, listener functions check whether certain criteria have been met. If so, the call's flag writes are performed, and if the check fails, nothing is written. With functions to check players entering certain areas, scoring a certain number of points, clearing graffiti, and many other things, we can now make the game react to all sorts of stuff happening by writing flags that non-blocking calls then read to decide whether to run. This is how much of the game's logic is implemented, like street challenges. Last up are blocking calls, in contrast to non-blocking calls. Blocking calls are different in that they take more than one frame to complete, and are run one at a time. On any frame where there isn't already a blocking function running, the game walks the list of blocking functions like it does the prior two lists, but once it finds a function with its conditions met, the game calls that function and stops walking the blocking call list until it's done. Once the call finishes, the game goes back to checking the list every frame, though it picks back up where it left off. You're actually able to call some blocking functions in the immediate call list too, and the game will likewise resume executing all the calls in the list once the blocking function finishes. These blocking functions are usually asynchronous or disruptive things, like pulling files in the background or playing a cutscene. In fact, the chapter intro cutscenes are just multiple smaller scenes chained together, using flags to activate another mini-scene once one piece finishes. I've covered everything in the abstract at this point, but to provide a practical example, I want to finish with a quick walkthrough of the mission that I made for the scripting demo. It actually only uses three of the four lists, but I think it ought to get the idea across. Here are our immediate calls. We spawn the player, set the music, create a detection plane, and show some text. The plane is defined in another block, and it covers one side of this topmost step here. This plane is used by a listener, which triggers when the player skates through. The listener is conditioned on mission flag 0, which we use to track whether the player has passed through the plane. If they have, the listener will set the flag to true, and it won't run anymore to avoid being triggered again. It also sets mission flag 1 to true, which we use to indicate that the second text message should be shown. That second message is in our list of non-blocking calls, It's checking every frame if mission flag 1 has been set to true, and when it is, it displays a message. It also writes two flags. It unsets mission flag 1 so that it's not called again the next frame, and it sets mission flag 2, which we'll use to say that we're waiting for the player to perform a 15-trick combo. Set flag, of course, is a condition on a listener for the combo. Once triggered, this flag does the usual song and dance of unsetting mission flag 2 and setting a new mission flag 3, which we'll just dub the combo completed flag. The second and third non-blocking calls are both conditioned on this flag, so they run, setting the music and showing a third message respectively. If the music call unsets the flag before we get the text call, it could prevent the message from being shown. So we don't have the music call write anything and only have the text call unset mission flag 3. Ugh. Now imagine how much more complicated all the scripting in the real game is. Phew. That might have been a bit of a lot, but I hope that all gave a good feel for how JSRF encodes its high-level logic. I've naturally skipped over a whole bunch, like all the different kinds of functions available, but I can only cover so much at a time, and, well, we haven't figured out all the functions quite yet. But realizing how much of a pain it is to keep track of all these flags, I have to wonder what the development experience was like. Did the creators of JSRF really have to get these all straight in their heads, or did they have some kind of custom language that compiles down to it, like Crash did? I doubt we'll ever know, but I find it interesting to wonder what it could look like. Whatever the case, though, I do hope that someday it'll be possible for us to put together big, interesting missions of logic like they did.